So the topic of this video is the Kirchhoff Voltage Law and the Kirchhoff Current Law. We'll start with the Kirchhoff Voltage Law. This is a very simple law, and what's nice about this law is that it applies to any circuit element. It doesn't matter whether the circuit element is a resistor or a capacitor or a solar cell or a battery. Anything in a circuit, this works. So it doesn't matter if something's linear or nonlinear, for instance. Let's draw an example circuit because I think this might be the easiest way to describe the Kirchhoff voltage law. So let's assume that we have an ideal voltage source, and let's give it a voltage of VDC. And we'll assume that we have a resistor. Let's assume that we have some unknown circuit element. I have no idea what it is. I'm going to represent it by a box. And then let's put another resistor on it. And then let's close the circuit. So what we have here is a loop, right? I can draw a loop, and even if I have other circuit elements on the circuit, this is still a loop around this part. I have another loop over here. Kirchhoff's voltage law says the following. For any given loop, the voltage as you end the loop has to equal the voltage at the start of the loop, and it makes sense. Otherwise, you would have some voltage gain as you go around the loop. So the voltages have to sum to zero. Let's label some of these voltages. And I've chosen the polarity in a rather arbitrary way. So we'll do it this way first, and then I'll show another example where I've inverted some of the polarities. It turns out not to matter at all. As long as the problem is worked in a consistent way, for any unknown quantity, it doesn't matter whether the minus sign is on top or whether the positive sign is on top. So let's now apply the Kirchhoff voltage law to the first loop. So I'll call this loop one, I'll call this loop two, and let's write it all out for loop one. So we have, starting from this point, a voltage rise of VDC. Then we have a voltage fall of VR, because you see it goes from plus to minus, therefore it's a voltage fall, so I put a minus sign in front of it. Now we have another voltage fall of VK from here to here. And then we have another voltage fall, VR2. And now I'm back to my starting point because they're connected with a wire. So these have to add up to zero. That's the Kirchhoff voltage law applied to loop one. Now let's apply it to loop two. And let's start from here. All right, so first we have a voltage rise of VR2 because it goes from minus to plus in the way I've drawn it. Then we have a voltage fall, VR3, and then we have another voltage fall of VR4, and those sum to zero. All right, so this is the Kirchhoff voltage law applied to this circuit. Now let's change some of the polarities and redo it. You see, anytime you have a voltage and it's labeled, you have to indicate the polarity along with the voltage. I can't just look at two wires and say, oh, there's 2 volts there. That doesn't make any sense at all. Well, when you say 2 volts, does it mean that this one is 2 volts higher than that one? Or does it mean that this one's 2 volts higher than that one? You see, you can't just say, oh, we've got 2 volts, right? That's why the laboratory DC power supplies all have a red cable and a black cable, meaning that the red cable is always the one that's 2 volts higher than the black one if you have the power supply set to 2 volts, right? So the polarity is always important. But what about situations where I don't know the polarity a priori? What if I don't know which side of a resistor is going to have a higher voltage or a negative voltage? Well, it doesn't matter if I'm trying to solve for the voltage. I can just label it however I want, and if I got the polarity wrong, I'm going to get a negative value for the answer. All right, so let's go ahead and apply the Kirchhoff voltage law using the polarities that I indicated here. Let's start my loop down here, and we'll work our way around the loop as follows. First, I have a voltage rise. Then I have another voltage rise, so I'm giving it a positive sign. Then I have a voltage fall. Then I have a voltage rise. And then I have a voltage fall. And those all have to add up to zero according to the Kirchhoff voltage law. All right, so the fact that I've labeled it plus and minus, the fact that I've labeled this one minus and plus, that doesn't matter. And the reason is that I know from just looking at the circuit that as long as VK doesn't have a power source in it, that this has to be the direction that current is flowing through the circuit, right? Because I have a voltage source here. Current will definitely flow out of the voltage source through the resistor. So this is a voltage fall, but I've labeled it as a voltage rise, which means that if I actually calculate VR1, it's going to be a negative number. VR2 is labeled as a voltage fall, so it's going to be a positive number. VK, I've labeled it as a voltage rise. However, if it is a passive component, meaning it doesn't have any power source, it doesn't have any voltage source or a current source inside of it, then V sub K will be calculated as a negative number. VR3 will be calculated as a positive number because I've labeled it correctly as a voltage fall, which matches the direction that the current is going to actually flow given the polarities I have on the circuit. All right, now let's discuss the Kirchhoff current law. The Kirchhoff current law is actually really simple. It says the following: if you have a junction with current coming in or out, and it doesn't matter really what's connected to it, it states the following: current in has to equal current out. Or, in other words, the sum of the current in plus the sum of the current out has to be zero. So let's apply the Kirchhoff current rule to an actual circuit. So let's say that this is 2 amperes coming in, and I measured it with an ammeter, for instance, and let's say this is 3 amperes. And then the problem is to find this current I. How would I do it? And when you look at the problem, you already see that, oh no, something's wrong. Look at that. We have 2 amperes flowing into the junction and we have 3 amperes coming out. But I is labeled with the arrow pointing outwards. That's impossible, right? Well, not really, not if you use negative numbers. So the current here, I, is obviously -1 ampere of current. That way, 2 minus -1 equals 3. It means that the current through this resistor is actually flowing in the opposite direction. But you see, because I've labeled the arrow from left to right, the current that I calculate has to be a negative number. The polarity on currents is very similar to the polarity on voltages. When calculating an unknown quantity in a circuit, it doesn't really matter what direction you draw the arrows, if you draw them up or down or side to side. And with voltages, if you put plus to minus or minus to plus, it doesn't really matter, because if your answer has the wrong polarity, you'll just get a negative number. Now let's work a more complicated example, and we'll use both of these together in order to find some unknown quantities. So let's assume here that we have a circuit with 10 volts, a DC source, a 10 ohm resistor, and let's label the current going through this resistance as I1. Let's put a current source with 2 amperes of current going through it. Then we have a wire, and let's label the current passing through that wire as I2. And let's put a resistor here of 10 ohms. Our goal is to find the unknowns I1 and I2. So this is our problem. And we can apply the Kirchhoff current law and the Kirchhoff voltage law in order to find these unknown quantities. So I have 2 variables in this problem. The first thing I'd like to point out is a distinction between the labels here on the current. So I2 is labeled here with an arrow. And down here I have a 2 ampere source labeled with an arrow. These are 2 very different quantities. I2, this is not a current source. This is a label, it's a measurement. In other words, this is not a source that forces a current I2 to flow through the wire. No, there's no source here, there's no forcing. It's the difference between saying I have a resistor that happens to have 2 volts across it versus a source that forces 2 volts to be across a resistor or across anything really, right? So this is just a label. All right, with that in mind, let's go ahead and use the Kirchhoff voltage law. So I'm going to start here with a loop. Let's call this a voltage rise. Let's call this a voltage fall. And let's call this a voltage fall. So I know that we've got a 10 volt rise, and then we have a voltage fall. So what is the voltage fall across that resistor? Well, V equals IR according to Ohm's law, so it's just 10 I1. Now we have another voltage fall. I'm going to continue my loop around like this. Another one, 10I2, and then the loop finishes. All right, I chose not to take this loop because I don't know what the voltage drop across a current source is. You might recall for a current source, if I plot V versus I, it's just a line. So you see the voltage could be anything. So it's not good if you're using the Kirchhoff voltage law to allow your loop to cross a current source. You're not going to get any information from it because you'll just have a variable voltage across that and you won't be able to solve for it. So that's why I chose the outer loop here. All right, we have two variables, so I'm going to need another equation in order to solve it. I'm not going to gain anything by using the Kirchhoff voltage law across this current source. So I'm left with the Kirchhoff current law. So let's go ahead and apply it at this node right here. And I can say current in equals current out. So current in is I1 and current out is 2 amperes plus I2. Now I have two equations and two unknowns. And I can solve these simultaneous equations. Let's take the second equation and plug it into the first. So I have 10 minus 10. Let's plug in I1. So this is 2 plus I2 minus 10 I2 equals 0. So we have 10 minus 20, which is minus 10. And then we have minus 20 I2 equals 0. And I2 is a negative number. It's just negative 0.5 ampere. Then I can plug this in to find I1 from here, which is 1.5 amperes. And we've finished the problem. If you enjoyed watching this video, then you might be interested in following our playlist and learning more about the fundamentals of electrical circuits.